Pranayama, the way to flow within. The word pranayama comes from two words, pran, which means life force. William Reich has called it as orgone, the energy particles. When you breathe in, the air comes in. But air is the container that brings the life force or the orgone or the energy particles within. Irrespective of the beliefs, caste, creed, everyone breathes. And when Leon Leford went to the Middle East in search of the masters of Gurdjieff, he met various Sufi masters, because in the Middle East, the most important way is the Sufi path. So the first master he met, he asked him, "What did you teach Gurdjieff?" He said, "I taught him how to breathe." Immediately a question comes, breathing, and you consider breathing as normal, but it is not so. There is a technique of bringing the breath in, and then how the breath dwells within. That is the entire system of pranayama or yoga. Yoga comes from the word to join, to unite. The air or the energy is outside. Just as all the food items are outside, you go and connect yourself in the supermarket with various food items, and when you connect with them, you bring it in inside the home, and then the process of the consumption in various ways begins. Certain things that you bring are to be consumed raw, other things in a different way. So when the energy particle or the life force or the air comes in, it activates the various centers and works differently. Then there is an entire science how it works. Just as when you bring the various items, there is a science of cooking, how you make those items consumable. Yoga works at the level of the body, the gross. And then there is awareness. Awareness works at the level of the mind, the subtle. Yoga is helpful, but it is only one part. The other part is mindfulness, which is very, very important. It is not a fancy to use the word mindfulness. You have to understand its anatomy, physiology, and everything that encompasses mindfulness. We do things mechanically. There is a physical mind, there is a mental mind, a spiritual mind. When you are driving the car, you are holding the steering, a thought process is there in you. Because in the morning you left the home after a minor brawl, so you are thinking something else, and your steering automatically moves towards the home. This is the physical mind. Mindfulness comes when you are aware of every single act. We live our life like a robot, continue to do things, and when you watch people walking on the road, absent-minded. Many times I have tried this with the people sitting there, it breaks a conversation, all of a sudden there is a diversion, a phone call comes, that conversation ends, and after a few seconds or minutes we come back to that, All the people who are there, they are not able to know even what was the last word that I was speaking, what the talk was all about. When I ask, they cannot point out what was the last words that I spoke or where I was speaking. The people who are listening, they are not doing anything. They are simply listening. I am speaking on a matter of spirituality or concerning how to work with the inner self. All of a sudden a call comes in where I have to deal with the matter of business, worldly affairs or anything else. I can return back to the same topic where I had left without a break. But the people who are listening, they cannot. This is what is meant by mindfulness. Normally we are not able to focus on one thing. The attention goes many times outside. But when mindfulness begins to operate, you can answer different people and there will not be any mix-up in that. I am speaking to someone on a matter and the next one a call comes in. Many times it happens. You are on a call, another call comes in, you put that call on the hold, the other call you attend and that is on a different subject. Observe. Are you able to return simultaneously, instantaneously to the talk where you have put the call on hold? A little effort will make you make this possible. When you are mindful of every single word that you speak and your physical mind is operating through the subtle mind, your steering does not move automatically towards the home. Instead, it is with total awareness. This is mindfulness. Practice yoga so that body becomes rhythmic. Through yoga, the body comes into a rhythm and begins to cooperate with inner movements. And simultaneously, you have to practice mindfulness. Without mindfulness, yoga will not work. And simultaneously practice mindfulness. Together, yoga and mindfulness will bring the process of transformation. You are working on the two fronts. You are using the techniques of yoga, the breathing exercises. But for what purpose? That comes in mindfulness. Asanas, that is the particular posture of sitting, training, and pranayama means the various aspects of breathing. The inhaling, the exhaling. Even in the Chinese system, there is emphasis on the breathing, the fire breath, and different types of breath in order to bring qi within us. And that's why there are whole set of qigong exercises. Asanas and pranayams are the methods through which energy can be made to flow inward. When the energy flows inward, they become one, they unite with one another. Because at the center there cannot be more than one. So the more energy goes inwards, the more harmony comes in. Conflicts drop. At the center there is no conflict. There is an organic unity of the whole. And that is why bliss is felt. Your body is sitting in a particular posture. You are aware of your breathing as it comes in and it goes out. That is, when the two are put together, it comprises the ancient technique of Vigyan Bhairav Tantra. The entire sutras of Vigyan Bhairav Tantra was translated into English by a Kashmiri mystic, Pandit Lakshmanju. Before that, these were in Sanskrit language. Now these have been translated in English, and then the commentaries are there. Both asanas and pranayama work at the bodily level, because it is through the body you go into various postures and in breathing techniques. Vast majority thinks that pranayama can help at mental level as well. But this does not happen. With pranayama, emotions enter the subtle layer. With pranayama, you are bringing the life force or the energy as it works on the subtle level. Emotions enter in subtle layer. Then you are not even aware of these emotions. Remember, both asanas and pranayams are important, but they are a physical help. If your mind is in conflict, then they will not be of much help, because body and mind are not two things really. They are two parts of one energy. You are not the body and mind. Instead, you are body-mind mechanism. Whatever happens to the body affects the mind, and vice versa. You are psychosomatic. We talk about the body as one thing and mind as something different. But body and mind are in fact two poles of the same energy. Body is gross and mind is subtle. But the energy is the same. And that is what we need to understand. One has to work from both polarities. From the body, there is Hatha Yoga, there are asanas, and we emphasize on those. There are pranayams, but for the mind, there is another type of yoga that is known as Raj Yoga, which is concerned with mental attitudes. Body and mind are one energy. For example, if you can control your breath, then you are in a position to control your emotions as well. If you are angry, anger will vanish. You remember the children make mischief, noise, the mother beats them, emotions are hurt, physically the child feels hurt, because we do not give attention to the child's point of view. Child's emotions are hurt and begins to cry. What do parents do? They say, "Hush, stop crying, otherwise I'll give you a slap again." How would a child whose emotions are hurt and he is crying, how would he stop crying? From the very childhood, we learn to hold our breath. The moment you hold your breath, after a few hiccups, you will be able to control the act that is happening at the physical level. And that sets a trend, and we continue to hold our breath every moment when there is a danger, when there is a fear, or things that are not in harmony with you, we hold our breath. If you can go on holding the breath, then certain things will vanish. If you can go on breathing rhythmically, anger cannot overpower you. In the same way, if you go on breathing rhythmically, sexual passions cannot arise or overpower you. So when during the act of sex, when you are mindful of your breathing, your attention is on that, this sudden upsurge of the energy will not be there, and you enter into another realm. This does not mean that it is not there. It will be there, but it will not manifest. No one will know it is there. Not even you will be able to know. So sex can be repressed, anger can be suppressed through rhythmic breathing. You can surpass them so much that you yourself will not be even aware of it. But the anger of sex will still be there, hiding behind and lurking from the basement for any small opportunity to surface. When you look at the life, many times circumstances and situations comes which do not even warrant, which do not even are necessary for the kind of emotional outbursts we exhibit. Simple thing happens, your spouse had asked you to do something and you forget because of some reasons. The whole scripture begins, this is how he is, he doesn't remember, he doesn't care for house, this and that. Similar thing happens when we are dealing with the workers. A mistake can happen from a boss who is in a higher position, but we overlook at that moment and we focus on what the mistake the subordinate has done. Through rhythmic breathing, you can suppress them so much that you yourself will not be aware of it, but anger and sex will be there, lurking from the basement for a single small opportunity. The body has suppressed it, but it remains inside untouched. One has to work both with the body and the mind simultaneously. At the mind, you can only work through mindfulness. The body should be trained through yogic methodology and the mind through awareness. You will require more awareness if you practice yoga because things will become subtle. If yoga is done without awareness, it will not be beneficial. With the bodily postures, you are trying to hold a particular posture. You are upset. You go and do things. As it is said that we go and do a workout, we go and do a swimming, and you feel relaxed. But you remember the cause that made you to go into workouts has gone deeper into you. Its level has changed and you will not be able to see. So the two things are very important. If you practice pranayama, you will need more awareness, more acute sensitivity to be aware of your anger, because now the anger will become even more subtle. The body is not cooperating with anger. You are sitting in a still position. There is no physical manifestation. Normally, when you get angry, your bodily expressions and gestures show the anger. But when you are holding a particular yoga position, it will not show, it will go deeper. You will remain mentally angry. your musculature will become that of anger. When things like these happen, people even do not know, they start doing certain things. For instance, when Prasenjit, king at the time of Buddha, he came to meet Buddha. Buddha was sitting and the sermon was going on. As the king reached, he thought he is the king of the place and Buddha is a subject. He will get up and welcome him, but in a master's place, everyone, no one is high or low. They are given no special attention. So Prasenjit came and he sat down. He was upset because he was not accorded the usual welcome that he was accustomed to. His big toes began to shake out of anger, out of disgust. Buddha, when his sermon, the meditation finished, he paid attention to him. Because at the time when you are in harmony with, in meditation, that is, you are in commune with the higher energy, that time paying attention to the smaller ones is disrespect to that high level of energy. I do not recall the name of the Sufi master. One of the Naqshbandi masters, he asked his son, as a part of training, to go and take care of the shrine of his master. So he used to remain on the shrine, cleaning, maintaining and taking care of the shrine was his work. He was a little boy. A couple years passed, the father passed and came to visit him again. Normally, what will happen at that time? A child, as soon as the father comes home, probably he was out of town, and he comes home, the child runs to hug the parents. But this boy, who happened to be the master, remained engrossed in doing his work that was assigned to him, cleaning and maintaining the shrine. And when he finished the job, he came and paid respect to his father. That time his father said, if seeing me, you have had left the work of taking care of the shrine, your all the effort of these years would have vanished. I remember when we used to visit the shrine complex of Sufi Brijmohan Lal. So the shrine was in the center. At the other corner, in the house where others were dwelling, I had seen, as soon as Sufi Omkar Nath will come, his first responsibility is to pay respect or pay salam to this sheikh whose shrine is there, because he is the most venerable on that complex. At that time, if anybody else comes, he will not pay attention. We learn from this. At the shrine complex, whosoever shrine is, that is most venerated one. And when you are paying, first and foremost duty is to pay the respect to that. But when we go to the shrine complex, first we pay attention to this and that and so. And then we go. You remember, the sheikh is waiting for you whose shrine is there. Instead of that, you engage in tea, this and that and so. When I went to Roza Sharif, after entering, Hazrat Zubair Muhammad Naqshbandi, who was the caretaker, he welcomed and he said, "Let's have tea." I said, "No, first and the foremost responsibility is to pay respect to the Sheikh, and then you do other things." So he said, "It will take a few minutes, a little time for the place to be opened and so. So in the meantime, you can have accept the curtsy." So I stood up right there and paid my respect to the Sheikh, that I am in your khanka, I am in your place. If there is any audacity in my not coming to pay you respect first, please forgive me and all those people who are coming with me in your company." And then after doing, then Hazrat Zubair asked me, I said, "First and the foremost thing is, when the custodian of this khanka is Hazrat Mujaddid Alif Sani Razi Allah Ta'ala Unu, his son Hazrat Khwaja Muhammad Masoom, Hazrat Khwaja Sheikh Saifuddin Razi Allah Ta'ala Unu, I must pay the respect to them first in order. First, Hazrat Mujaddid Alif Sani Razi Allah Ta'ala Unu, because he is the most venerated. Then Hazrat Khwaja Muhammad Masoom, then Hazrat Khwaja Sheikh Saifuddin Razi Allah Ta'ala Unu. And after that, all other things are important." This was the way when you enter. So what actually happens when you practice the yoga, your anger and those things enter into the subtle layers and you will not know, your musculature will change. I was telling you that the musculature, the body changes. We do not even know. Because we are a priest or imam, or we have to act in a particular way in the society, in front of the people, but the anger that you have been suppressing, where will it go? It will manifest through the body. So sometimes it happens, as it happened in case of Prasannajit, his big toe began to shake and he was not even aware of it. I have seen some people, they are priests, giving big sermons, doing the puja and all these things. But whenever they are in my company or otherwise, their shoulder shrugs or shakes even without their knowing. You are driving, you don't need to do. If you want to stretch, then you can do it consciously. All of a sudden, you will see as if there is a jerk in the shoulder. This is what, when the energy has gone into the subtle layer and you had been doing things without awareness. When you are doing the cooking at home, your garbage bin is full, you immediately remove it and place it in the right place. Garbage bins should never be placed after they are full right outside the door. They should immediately be disposed of in the place where they are supposed to go. But we accustom keeping the garbage bins, garbage bags right there. As long as it is, the bag is in the bin, it is okay. But when it is finished and it is ready to go, it must go immediately where it's supposed to go. If you leave it there, many things can happen, and spiritually it is not right. All that was unwanted should be disposed of right away. In the same way, the anger, all those emotions should immediately be disposed of, and they can only be disposed of through mindfulness, through awareness. So mindfulness or awareness is not a mere word. It is a practice at a particular level. When you practice awareness techniques and yoga methods simultaneously, you will know the deeper realms of awareness. Otherwise, you will be aware only of the gross. If you change the gross but you do not change the subtle, you will be in a dilemma. Now, conflict will assert itself in a new way and you will not be even aware of it. Yoga is helpful, but it is one part. The other part is what Buddha calls mindfulness. Practice yoga so that body becomes rhythmic and cooperate with your inner movements and simultaneously practice mindfulness. As when we are doing the training in mindfulness, what I am doing here. I was talking to you on a particular topic, in a particular direction, all of a sudden I changed it. And when I came back to the same spot. Listen to the talk again and then you will realize. In order to do this, how one can learn these techniques of mindfulness? Simple thing, my uncle Sufi Omkarnath asked me to write your diary, daily diary, and in the diary you write the events, not very minor events. During the day there are certain events which are important, certain events need attention. So what I used to do, I found my own way. The day begins from the time you wake up, and when you go to sleep, that is when the day ends. So sometimes I will write in the events starting from the beginning to the last event. But you remember when 10 o'clock in the night you are writing the events, event at 9:49 is fresh in your mind, whereas the one that is 5 o'clock in the morning is not there. So you have to stress your mind. Then other times I used to do in a reverse process. Write the last event first and go on writing in the other way. So I am trying to recollect those. It sharpens your memory. At the same time, when you are angry, you are simply acting out of emotions. Now you are introspecting. I should have not got angry at that time. But your apology should be to you that this particular emotional outburst, because of which I get angry at the person, should have not been there. This is our legacy. Our parents have acted in a particular way. We go on acting in another way. There is always conflict. When the conflict arises between husband and wife over a trivial matter, if the child comes and asks something, "Dad, I want this," because you cannot do the spanking to your wife or husband, to your boss or anyone, so you take out on the one that is more vulnerable. So you take and spank the child. Do you ever recollect that? Why did you do that? It is out of the habit. There has to be a breakthrough in that. This is how I was brought up. This is how our parents lived. If I have to bring a 90 degree turn in my life and move into the inner life, I have to break those habits, which are my inheritance. Such moments comes in the life of everyone But are you aware of it? No, we are not aware of it. Mindfulness is not a word, it is a technique. At that time, are you mindful of, or you just skip it? That is not necessary. No, it should not be. This is how my parents lived and brought me up. I am not going to bring up my children like that. I am not going to react in the same way as I have inherited. The process of change begins. This is mindfulness. You sowed the first seed of mindfulness. These simple examples come in life of everyone, writing the diary. Then when I am beginning to read, it is a self-illumination, introspection. And then he used to say that when you write the weekly diary and give it to me, in the meantime I used to give it to him, he will read it and he will just put his initials. After some time, then he told me, you don't need it to give it to me, because the process of that was finished. It was a lesson in mindfulness. Another example, simple thing. My grandmother, Sufi Shakuntala Devi, she had a register of accounts. She used to write her accounts, day-to-day expenses. On one side, the money, the income, the other side of expenses. You spend the money throughout the day on different things. This was based because that time there was no credit card or any other method. Because when you write pay through the credit card, sometimes even that you forget. So you keep your receipts. Or if you issue a check, then you have a counterfoil, the receipt, so you have a proof that you have issued a check. But what about the cash transactions? At the end of the day, when you are balancing the cash, you do not remember where the money went. And you are trying to balance, and many people even do not bother about maintaining the cash balance. When I finish my day's work, I'm talking about wherever I have to go, do the business transactions, delivery, this and that, and so there are collections, there are expenses. When I return home, my first responsibility is maintaining the accounts, a proper accountability, that how much the cash expenses went, because the checks and credit card is recorded already. And then balance the cash at the end of the day, that I collected so much of cash, so much went into the expenses, and that should balance. And that is what the proper accountability is. It is a lesson in mindfulness. You have to recollect and you have to remember that when you have spent the money on buying a particular thing, maybe certain things you buy and consume right away and you do not even recollect. Certain things you bought and you brought it, you have a bill with you. So it's a simple thing, we have kept the bills with us when we come. Certain bills that you have to keep in order to account for, others you discard immediately. These are the exercise in mindfulness. But when it comes to the emotions and things like these are concerned, then you are doing there are breathing exercises, you are doing the yoga postures to bring a certain kind of discipline. Be mindful of breathing. In yoga, you have to change the breathing process. In mindfulness, you have to be aware of the breathing as it is. So when the Sheikh told Leon Leopold, we go on breathing without even mindfulness. We go breathing unconsciously. Just as heart continues to beat even without your knowing. This is unaware. So in yoga, you can use the different breathing process, the rhythmic, the reversible. You are inhaling is natural, but we do not exhale. And when you exhale, because when the air comes in, it works within the system, and then it must be exhaled, and then the same amount of air has to be exhaled. You look at these days. We have the apartments, houses with air conditioner. And when you are cooking, the air gets polluted. And if it is not, you do not have an exhaust, that smell will remain within, because the air conditioner does not, it only purifies the air because of the filter, but the smell remains. So we have the system of putting the exhaust. We have a mini exhaust on top of the stove, and then a bigger exhaust when the kitchen is bigger. So all that air is extracted out. This is exhaling. The system, your house is exhaling, throwing out the toxic air. The environment inside remains, the air inside remains pure. In the same way, inhaling is a normal process, but exhaling is an effort. So certain pranayams where you only exhale, which is Kapalbhati, it brings inner purity. You exhale. Then there are reversible, breathing from the right and the left nostril, breathing from the one nostril and exhaling from the other. You remember the nostrils are connected directly to the two sides of the brain, the left and the right. And if you notice that the two nostrils are never open, you breathe only from one side. And in that, the inner balance between the emotional and the logical aspect is never established in the people. Either you are emotional or you are logical. Meditative person is one who is neither emotional nor logical, but the two have merged into one another. The right brain and the left brain have merged into one another. This comes through, you can do this reversible breathing, which is called anulom vilom, but you will do it mechanically. The moment there is awareness, there is mindfulness, that's why I emphasize mindfulness at the level of the mind. And the physical level, you are inhaling from one nostril and exhaling from the other. So what happens there? In yoga, you have to change the breathing process. Now you are going into reversible breathing, or you are going into the exhaling. You are exhaling with a force. The exhaust fan works at a high speed. Its RPM is more than that of an air conditioner. If you turn on the exhaust, its RPM is more than that of an air conditioner. It works with a very soothing voice. Exhaust all of a sudden starts. Because the hot air, the air which is polluted, has to be thrown out immediately before it assimilates into the inner environment. So it has to be done forcefully. That is why exhaling is with a force. Inhaling is normal. So you have to be in yoga. You are changing the breathing process. Now here, when you put on, just observe in your house the exhaust, the speed of the exhaust, the sound of the exhaust fan, and that of the air conditioner. There is a difference. Exhaust is an example of mindfulness, and Air conditioner is an example of breathing process. In mindfulness, you have to be aware of breathing as it is. This is the difference between yoga and awareness. Just be aware of it. If you can become aware of your breathing, then you can be aware of your thoughts process as well, not otherwise. Then thoughts will not disturb you at all. If you try to become aware of your thought process directly, this will not work. It will be very arduous. Breathing is the door to the mind. If you stop breathing even for a single moment, there will not be any thoughts. Your thoughts will stop. That is why when a person dies, he is breathing no more, there is no more thoughts. When breathing stops, the thought process ceases. If your thinking is chaotic, your breathing will be chaotic. Breathing will simultaneously reflect your thought process. Buddha gave a yoga, a meditation. It is called yoga of awareness of incoming and outgoing breath. And it is known as vipassana meditation or anapanasati yoga. The yoga of awareness of incoming and outgoing breath. He says, begin from here. And that is the correct beginning. One should begin from the breathing and never from the thought process itself. When you can feel the subtle movements of breath, only then you will be able to feel the subtle movements of thoughts as well. This is the beginning of mindfulness. Awareness of the thought process will change the quality of the mind, while the asanas or pranayams will change the quality of the body. It is very scientific. Then the movement comes, when your body and the mind are in harmony with one another, without any conflict at all. When they are synchronized, you are neither body nor the mind, and for the first time you know yourself as self and transcend. You know, two things are very important. One is birth, the other is death. And what is between birth and death? Do you know what is between birth and death? Birth begins with B, birth, and death is D. These are the two acts. Through birth you come into life, and through death you exit. Between the two is a letter called C. B, C, D. The spiritual alphabet finishes in three letters. Birth, death, and in between C. What does C denotes? Consciousness. Birth, consciousness, and death. Breathing in, consciousness, breathing out. Three letters, the spiritual science is finished. Between birth and death, if you are conscious, you are mindful of every act, every moment, you do not need to read any scripture. All the scriptures I can discard. If the moment consciousness comes, the moment mindfulness comes, and awareness, or it begins with consciousness. You are conscious of each act. Awareness of thought process will change the quality of the mind, while the asanas and pranayams will change the quality of the body. And then the process of transcendence begins. So remember, three letters are more important than anything else. B, C, D. Birth, consciousness, and death. Finished. The spiritual science is finished. If there is no consciousness between birth and death, you are vegetating. And if there is consciousness between birth and death, every action is guided by awareness, then you have transcended. you have reached the inner center, your movement to the inner center will be natural without any problem. You can transcend only when there is no conflict. In this harmonious moment when body and the mind are one, there is no tug of war, there is no conflict, you transcend both. You are neither the body nor the mind. Now you are nothing in a sense. You are simply consciousness, not conscious of something, but you are just pure consciousness, and that is what pure awareness is. And the moment you can say, Aham Brahmam Janami, Brahma means consciousness. Yes, I know consciousness. You are a Brahman. You are learned. One who knows consciousness, Aham Brahmam Janami, Main Brahma ko janta hu. I have encountered consciousness as an embodiment. Then I am learned. Not otherwise. You are not Brahman by birth. You are Brahman by awareness. And one who has known it, there is nothing else left to be known in the three universe. This awareness without being aware of anything is indeed the moment of explosion. The sea has come between B and D. It was always there, but you were not aware what C represents. In the books, you are taught C for cat, B for boy, and D for dog. But C for awareness, B for birth, D for death, this is a spiritual science. Birth, consciousness, and death. Every moment it happens. When you die to this particular moment with awareness, you are living moment to moment in nowness. A moment of explosion comes. You actualize your inner potentials. You explode into a new realm, the ultimate. This ultimate is the concern of all religions, not the rituals, going to do this and that. Instead, this explosion into a new realm of awareness is the essence of spirituality, is the essence of all religions, irrespective of their origin, irrespective of anything else.